Today, the capital sin is envy. And we know that envy means that we see what others have that we don't have, or at least we think others are blessed beyond us, whether materially or with talents, with holiness. And so we see something that others have and we don't have, and it makes us sad because of our self-love, our pride. We want to be as good or better than others. And when I think of the sin of envy, I think of the example, the sad example of the Pharisees. They hated our Lord, they plotted his death, and they eventually brought about his death, these rulers of the Jewish people. Why? Why did they dislike him so much? It's because they knew he was better than they. And so it was envy. Yes, it starts with pride, but particularly it was their envy of him. The people would say, never has a man spoken like this man. And the Pharisees and the scribes and the leaders were used to the people coming to them to have their questions decided and to get advice and so forth. And now they were going to our Lord. And so they didn't like that loss of importance or reputation. So envy is defined as a sadness at the good of another. And we want to distinguish between envy and jealousy. Oftentimes we use the terms interchangeably, but they really are two different things. Jealousy is wanting to keep something we have and not to share it, or not to give it to others. Whereas envy is a dislike of someone because of something they have that we don't have. Now, jealousy can be used in a good sense. In Scripture, it refers to God as a jealous God, meaning that he wants our love for himself, to whom it belongs. So in that sense, God is a jealous God. He's jealous of our love. He wants it for himself, our total dedication and service. But envy, again, is sadness at the good or the perceived good of another. So I'll read the section here. Envy is willful grieving on account of another's good, spiritual or temporal, which is regarded as diminishing one's own. Thus, the honor paid to another is regarded by the envious man as reflected disgrace on himself, and he is sad in consequence. Envy is not emulation, which may be good or bad. Now, of course, emulation is seeing the good in another and wanting to imitate it, wanting to become like it, wanting to put that virtue into practice in our lives. And that can be a good thing, to emulate those who are more advanced in the spiritual life, want to imitate their virtue. So emulation, envy is not emulation, which may be good or bad, but it is rooted in uncharitable sadness at the absence in oneself of some good perceived in another or possessed by another. Nor is it hatred, which loathes the good of another as that other's good, nor is it sadness at the power of another, insofar as that power may be harmful to oneself, nor is it indignation at the unworthiness of another to possess something good. Envy is rooted in pride and self-esteem, and inclines a man so to love his own excellence as to wish another to be without some good that lessens or appears to lessen what the envious man has just because another hasn't. The vice is fostered usually in respect to those who are our equals, or nearly so. Since envy is opposed to charity, it is in general a grievous sin, though it may be accidentally venial if the envied excellence is slight. In order to be a grievous sin, the good envied must be a great and momentous one, and the envious man must deliberately wish another to be without that good, insofar as it is a diminution of his own. There are, of course, degrees, even in grievous envy, in accordance with the magnitude of the good envy. Thus, envy of another's spiritual gifts of a high order is more grievous. So, more grievous envy of another's spiritual good than an envy of another's temporal or material good. The sins to which envy ordinarily leads are hatred, detraction, murmuring, resentment at another's good fortune, and joy in his adversity. The envious man is glad when he hears that someone else whom he envies, that some evil befell that person. He secretly rejoices in that. And of course, that's a terrible sin, to rejoice at harm or evil that comes to another. The remedies against this vice are to love one's neighbor and ask God to increase that love, to rejoice in his success as though it were your own, to congratulate him in success, to pray for his success, to thank God for it, to consider that one's neighbor is better than oneself, as explained under the virtue of humility, to consider that naturally envy spoils one's relations with others and one's character, and may, if grievous, deprive one of heaven. That envy is truly diabolical, because by it one begrudges God his glory. That the envious persecute themselves. They are most unlike Christ with his boundless love, and God, who wishes not the death of the sinner, but that he could be converted and saved. And you think about the envious man, what a miserable person. Because he's always unhappy in seeing the talents, the virtues, the goodness of others, and being saddened by it because he knows he doesn't have it. Why not strive? First of all, thank God that that other person has those virtues or those gifts, etc. And second, strive to emulate, to practice those virtues, to become like that person. But again, the envious person is miserable. He's always saddened by seeing these things in others. Finally, the virtue contrary to envy is love of one's neighbor, which will be treated under charity in this book. So, love of neighbor overcomes that envy. Now, I think that there's a wonderful prayer, I know you're all to some degree familiar with it, the Litany of Humility. It was composed by Cardinal Mary Duval, who was Pope St. Pius X's Secretary of State and his most trusted cardinal. And he composed this and recited it himself every day for his thanksgiving after communion. But one of the petitions in the Litany of Humility is that others become holier than I, provided that I become as holy as I should. And what a beautiful prayer that is, that it should not bother us, that we see others better than us, more virtuous than us. We praise God for that, give thanks to him, that they are practicing those virtues, and in our part, strive to become as holy as we should. So let us be on our guard against envy. It is a very subtle sin, very sometimes difficult to detect, because the envious man thinks that he's right in his thoughts about others. But if he'd only step back and look at it, he would see in himself that same sin that the Pharisees and other rulers of the Jews had towards our Lord. And you can see what it led them to, a point of utter blindness, and again, plotting the death of our Lord. They hated him so much because of their envy. And of course, the devil's hatred of us is primarily rooted in envy, because the devil sees us as friends of God, souls destined for heaven, which he lost by his sin. So he is envious of the good we have now and we can attain in heaven. And that is why he hates us and plots our destruction. So let us avoid envy at all costs. Rather, when you see good in others, give thanks to God for it. Praise Almighty God, who is so lavish in his blessings to all of his creatures. And thank God for the good that we have, without wanting to necessarily be better than others, but to remember that prayer in the Litany of Humility, that others may become holier than I, provided that I become as holy as I should.